prison, there are spokers. First, I request Mr. V. Selvakumar to present his paper.
Such as I worked on ancient measurement, I will not go into the detail. And also we have evidence of a scale from Kalimangan, terracotta scale. And also her hairpin measurement system is very interesting. We have eight measures which have been studied by Renfro. They also indicate how people approached these economic issues. Coming to the linear and area measurement units, we have a lot of references in the medieval inscription. My focus was to look into these inscriptions and collect the references related to the measurement rods and try to correlate them with the measurement rods marked on the temple walls. If you go to many of the temples, you find sometimes two plus marks with the vertical marks in between, sometimes trident mark. They tell about the traditional measures. So these are, I will not go into the detail. We have Puri, Mona, and Veli, which Professor Subrayalu already mentioned. We have some of these measurement rods marked on the temple. So my task was to actually go to the site and take the measurement of the actual measurement marking, which are mainly found in the temple, either outside the sanctum or sometime in the gopura or sometime in the circumambulatory passage, to measure them and try to correlate with the traditional scale. That's what I did for this particular project. And this is from the site of Thirumanipudi. You have a measurement rod indicated, you know, in this way. One end, sometimes there will be two marking. One end there will be either a trident line or sometimes plus kind of mark. In the center you find this kind of vertical mark. Sometimes what happened is, in some of the temples people have displaced the stones. It's very difficult to relocate them, and we find sometimes isolated marks like cross. We don't have corresponding marks. So what we did was we documented all at several temples and tried to measure. Here this is from Thirumanipudi, where actually Vadivanan was working here. I was also part of the project documenting. Here sometimes you find the inscription and also corresponding marks which they are pointing out. This two plus mark here, and you can see the Esther page. And we documented at several sites. This is from C.A. Mangalam, which has been published by Archaeological Survey of India in South Indian Inscriptions. And here, this is Padnaru Chankol. We documented this measures actually to 392 centimeter. So this is from Pudukkottai. So this is from Nangavaram temple. And this is the milestone found near Dharmapuri. So we documented measurement rods at several temples. Actually, Tirukkarai, which has been published by Vedachalam, also has several measurement rods. And sometimes we documented all the measurement rods and distributed variation, how their size varies. You get sometimes very small marks. We don't know what for they made there. They could have used it for architectural purpose. We do not know that whether they were used for architectural purpose or for land measurement. Some of them, especially the small ones, were used for architectural purpose, and the larger one, sometimes they have the names, they were used for land measurement. Coming to the measurement rods, we also feel that there are certain schemes described in Arthashastra, which has been written by Balasubramanian and Michel Danino. We find three schemes of Muram or Vitasthi, the double span. One coming to 39 cm to 40 cm in length, another at 45, another at 50. So this scheme is very interesting indeed. And again, it could be because of sheer coincidence. We know it is very difficult to argue at this stage whether the idea has moved from here or there. I think that is a very secondary. What is interesting is that we find certain schemes and certain patterns to the measurement falling around 40 centimeter, 45 centimeter, and 50 centimeter in the for a Muram or cubit. That pattern we noticed, and this particular graph shows the distribution of the measurement rods as described in the core in the inscriptions. We find frequent reference more from after 900, as Professor Surayo pointed out. Then we have minute description of land remaining in the Chola inscription, and then frequency decreases after 1300. This could be something related to the quantity of the inscriptions which are found in this period, and also this is the spatial distribution, we find higher number in Kanchipuram and Madurai and Pudukottai and in certain areas near Vilupuram and Virudhunagar. Again, this pattern, I know many temples, they have not been documented. So we, after getting this project, I started visiting, and you find a number of references. What we have documented is only very minimal, because we couldn't go with, considering the limitation of the project, we couldn't visit all the sites. Subsequently, wherever I am visiting, you know, I am trying to locate some of the measurement markers. Sometimes it is difficult to date them. So we could date them on the basis of the temple construction date of the possible mandapa, or very few of them have this inscription. For example, Kanchipuram Varadaraja Perumal has Tachamudam and Kandragandan code. Similarly, in Tenkarai, there are specific names. Otherwise, many of them do not have names. So it is very difficult to document. So another thing, what we did was we tried to correlate the descriptions in the inscription along with the measurement rod. This is something interesting we found at the site of Belpadi, which is the Palipadai of Arniyai Sodan. And here the land description is very beautiful. It mentions about river Duga, the river is there, and land connected to the Palipadai temple, and a highway of 2 crore width, and another highway of 4 crore width is spoken. On the other side, there is Somanathishwara temple, which is existing. In this case, this particular, we also tried to document them on the ground. This particular highway is gone, it is not there. River is intact, so we could easily make out this Palipadai temple is there, on this side Somanathishwara. We measured this. Interestingly, it measured about 396 into 2, somewhat matching with the Pragadishwara temple. The sanctum size. That is something interesting. In the inscription, what it says, Engalur Alandu Kurita Padinet Kadi Kolinal, Padinet Zan Kolinal, and that comes. So, very clearly, the inscription also says that sometime they measured the village and then divided. So, this process has happened in several places. In this village, it's very clearly. And again, what we did was we tried measuring here. This is the Zarniya Soda Palipadai, and this is the four, this highway of 4 crore width. This is there. So when we enter, it is 10.32 meter. And this point, we actually, what we did was we measured from the ASA's boundary. So this measurement also, we don't know how far it accurate, but definitely it indicates that the landscape that we see on Google, all the plots, sometimes, if you look at some of the Brahmadaya villages, they are perfectly square plots. They were actually designed and measured and reallocated in a particular period of time. We don't know when. So probably for the purpose of calculation, not only they created these kind of cookies, they also actually measured, and they also, if you look at the land description, sometime it is kudi in terms of 3000, 2000. They had a penchant for this kind of numbers. That also occurs. Sometime it is 2560. So which is a multiplication of 16. So if you are using 16 span rod, you will end up with this kind of measurement. So at some point of time, they switch over from the 16 based number to 100 base. That is why we get more of, kudi being standardized to 2000. So, we have not completely finished this work, but interestingly, when we look at it, we see a lot of pattern how they people visualized these numbers. I will just quickly go into this. Again, what we did was we also tried to measure the spacing and the organization of Bragadishwara temple. Yeah, architectural measurement was also part of this. Interestingly, we could find this 10 times how they place the central circle of the Bragadishwara temple. How did they space around? If you look at it, it is 39.4 or 39.3 meter, which is again, I think, but a 16 span rod. So we could correlate somewhat the CM Mangalam rod of 392 centimeter of 16 span rod, and it is multiplication of 10 times left on all three sides. If you actually, Peshawar has published this book on Bragadishwara temple. In fact, he doesn't discuss this particular aspect. When you match this, it is very clear that they have used this measurement rod. Even in Bragadishwara temple, there is a measurement rod marked in the second gopura inside on the left hand side, but that doesn't match with this kind of scheme. That is probably, we don't know. Even in the same temple, we find several marking. It is very difficult to find the date of it, when exactly they marked. So the temple could be one period, the marking could be later period. Even here the Nandi Mandapa, there is a small scale mark just below. That could be of 16th, 17th century. But again, this is only a guesswork. It is very difficult to estimate. This is the map, you know. This is the actual measurement that we did. Recently, ASI did some concert restoration. There is some variation in this area. So here you can see how they have schemed this, you know, layout. So we also looked into these Kudi units. Now by using different kind of rods, we can arrive at different Kudi. So when you have some cases, 256 Kudis make one mark, 512 Kudis make one mark, 128 Kudis make one mark. Why? This could be because of that difference in the rod. Sometimes when you use 16 span rod, the span, you know, is different. When you use the 8 span rod, it varies, you know. This is the reason why we have this kind of variations. We need to do more to understand. These are some of the measurement rods. I am rushing through because I have limited time. Manai Kol, Malai Kudi Kol, they occur in Tenkarai temple. And Nanjai Kol, Punjai Kol, Natalav Kol, Uralav Kol. We try to calculate, you know, Enkidi Kol, Narchon Kol, and nine was named as different one. Onpathu, 10 less than 1. You know, we have a lot of things to look into. 14 feet rod, all that details. We also see some kind of ratio between dry land and wetland measurement that we come out, you know, how they were taxing in terms of yield 1:1.5. Sometimes when they wanted to tax properly, they increased the measurement rod. So in the case of dry land, they used a different measurement rod. And this is a Google map of Sabir Maulani village. You can see this very perfectly, square rods. That means they have intensely designed, and we need to go and do some more measurement. We also did some measurement on the ground. This is from a field from my village, where my father also, so we noticed certain patterns, you know, how we could equate them to 19 rods. And also sometimes the old elderly people in Tanjavur, they clearly remember, you know, what is one belly and how many mass and all. And then comes the weight measurement. In this also we did some matching. We calculated the weight of this Kundimani and the Manjari, and also that is the Karanja seeds. And try to correlate it. Interestingly, we find that the Harappan measurement is, you know, they are not trying to correlate this with the Tamil measurement. Generally, try to see this Harappan measurement system was based on seeds, based on 8 Kunja seeds. That is how they come with this basic unit of 0.89 mg. Actually, Mayank Bhatia, Nisha Yadav, they have published a paper recently. So, this we worked on that. And also, we tried, this is the weight, we measured the weight of this Kudimani and then Manjari and tried to correlate. And also, I did the documentation of Tanjavur and Ishwar temple ornaments. So, that ornaments they give in very detailed and they help us to understand what is the size of the various ornaments. If you look at Tirupati Gai, see, we have, derived that weight of this Kudimani. Kunja seed based on the actual measurement, which is 110 milligrams, is taken as standard. If you look at Uttinvayal and Tirupati Gai, you have these, assuming this is again an assumption, they have selected same kind of pearls and other ornaments for a particular time. Then in the case of Uduthu, we have a very heavier pearls. So here by understanding, analyzing these weight, right, we could understand that variation. Also, these are the grain measures standard. This is a volume storage, grain storage in Raghadishwara temple, and it has this 110, 300 unit. We try to correlate this with the contemporary paddy that is used, and this is Sabir Maulani Marathon, which is found in Sabir Maulani village. Probably it is a later copy of an older one, which is available in the archaeology department. And we try to arrive at the volume measure based on this, and we do find some kind of correlation, you know, between these. And sometimes what we see as a marker We normally think of one marakal as a one unit. Sometimes they decide a marakal when while at a time with pressure two or three units. So we, what we found was this particular marakal had a higher volume. Normally, we, though we call it as a marakal, it is not some villages you see one marakal will have two or three units. So there you have to be very careful so that they wanted to measure fast. And also we have a standardization of marakal as mentioned by Professor Subbarao as a Rajahesari marakal and Adalval marakal. There are several measurements and also the Nagavaram inscription mentioned about collecting soil from the tank and desilting it and depositing, and it gives a detailed calculation about 140 baskets per day and what is the salary and all that. We try to estimate that. So finally, there are some conclusions that we arrived at. Actually, I want to put the entire presentation because it's a very long. There are two such projects binding. So one thing we found was the measurement system was very much more complex than we think. It was much more complex than what we think. And though we call we get a reference to 16 span rod in two places, it is not necessary that 16 span rod of Tanjavur and 16 span of rod of Chengalpattu are exactly the same. So the process is much more complex than we think. Simply, we can't take that, they talk about 16 span rod and these two 16 rods were matching perfectly. So I think we need to go into the measurement of the land and actual measurement of the marks that are found in the villages, and also we need to encourage the local people to comprehend. And that it is a very vast area where we need more work. Actually, as pointed out very recently, we need to do mapping of the measures by region and time scale, and documentation at sites, and symbols and quotations, and actual correlation with the text. So only then, and also we need to do field measurements. Look at the cross references. We need to proceed from my experience. I think it's a very complex area. It is not something which you can directly take the references in found in the inscription. Sometimes some of the students who collected the data, they just collected the data of Padanarachan Kol or something. There, if you read the inscription, Padanarachan Kol Rajendra Sodanam. It occurs somewhere in Karnataka. So if we look at the inscription, we found there are much more complex expressions. We need to read the entire text to collect and also look into more complex factors. So it is a very complex area. I think people have used their own schemes in different parts, and that is why we do find a lot of variation. In near Edayalam, there is a measurement scale which is 347 cm. Whereas in CM Mangalam near Vidupuram, we have 392 cm. That means that different territories had a different kind of scales. Only thing what we need to do is, like Professor Subbarao has mapped this Nadu territories, we need to see how exactly what is the application of a particular measurement rod in a region, whether it was confined to that particular village or it extended beyond, and how it exactly is reflected on the ground. Now with the Google Earth map, I think we can easily test, at least we can estimate, and then we can go for ground truthing to check how exactly these measurement rods match. And especially we have a measurement rock near Edayalam, measurement mark on a rock. In that case, we could compare those marks with the neighboring fields rather than comparing with far away. So basically, empirical work starting from the village level or temple level can yield more research, and uncorrelation with the text, these could help us to understand the measurement scheme better than.
Might be a slightly
angular, as I said, there are three different Arthasastra. One that is used for land measurement, the one that is used for architects, that is entirely different. So sometimes, see, in the, for hydrography they use palm. In the case of land, they use adi. So from my analysis, I found what in one case, adi is 24.5 centimeter, span comes to 19 centimeter. So we find at least three major categories which are discussed by Arthasastra, which we also find on the ground. There is one 4-foot rod coming to 84 centimeter. It is marked in Engen temple. So in some cases, it is one. In some cases, in the case of Rajaraja's, it is 392 divided by and its multiplication. So right at the basic level, the Angulam did not vary much. You do find the three variation. But again, angulum is in relation to the maximum. So when you have a scale and then you reduce it to 12, sometimes they also play the combination of 24, 26, 27, and then multiplying it, then again reducing it by 12. So you get a lot of combination. But the overall pattern that we get is, as I said earlier, the concentration 40 centimeter, 45, and 50. There are larger ones also. So the feet or foot rod will be sometime 24 foot. If you come to the general period, you get longer. Probably that is meant for measuring the land at the fastest pace. Suppose if you are using a 8 feet rod, you need more time. So for practical purposes, when the people want to survey, they probably double it. So while at one level, the angular measurement did not change. At another level, there are three variations. And again, we cannot compare an angulum. Angulum is a relative measurement. We cannot say that it is equivalent to a centimeter. It varies, but we do find certain pattern where one category of angulum is equal to 1.75, 1.76. Again, you multiply 1.76 by 14 and then divide by 12, you get a difference. So that is where adi, from my understanding, in the case of adi, they have multiplied 14 angulum and then that is how adi comes. So span, we also did some human measurement, I didn't show. Span is 12, adi foot is 2 angulum more. But if you are trying to assume and reduce the calculate, divide it by again 12, you will get a different figure. Again, it is a play of figures and numbers.
Sir, you given alkali kumimai. Is it to 0.8? Will you explain?
Actually, what we did was, will you explain the alkali measurement system? Yeah, alkali measurement system, the basic unit is 0.89 gram. That's what I have not studied alkali measurement directly. I took the data from Mayank Wagia and Nisha Yadav from Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. They have published a paper in which they say the basic unit is 0.89 gram. So what I did was, from my analysis of Raghadeeshwara temple ornaments, what we did was, rather we did not depend upon earlier references, we directly collected the kundimani or bunja seeds across cricket areas and then measured. We arrived at a figure of 110 milligram multiplied by 8, it comes to 88, which is equal to 89 roughly. So our idea is that the Harpan system, so they went from 8 base number, 8 and then 16, 32, 64. That is the scheme that they use. In the Harpan kind of measurement system, you get stones which are 1:2, 2:4, 8:16, 32. That scheme is perfectly represented. Even I learned some of our early historic sites in Tamil Nadu also have produced weights and measures, and we have not done any documentation on that. Somebody told me they have found some weight measures from the site of KDT. We have not worked on that. But what we are trying to do say is that these measurement systems, in the case of linear, it was based on body. In the case of weight, it is based on seed. In the case of volume, that also we did. We counted 360 men, and that kind of, you know, reptile order to be counted. That also matches, but interestingly, we find some variation that I didn't elaborate in detail. So 360 nil, and why 360 number has to come again 360 days, and again in front of the term to zero gives a detailed calculation. We did go to the other grains. We mainly stuck to this paddy grains and counted, and then matched with that. From our understanding, it matches with the traditional measurement with the error of less than 5%. And again, we can't assume that, you know, whatever measurement people did in the medieval time, they were perfectly, you know, matching like what we do in modern material measures. They could give some kind of error margin of, you know, 2 to 5%. Yeah, that's what we tried. 8 ginger seeds, 110 milligram multiplied by 8, which matches with that. But our main interest is not happen, because that is one parallel that they have when we wanted to analyze the system. We also looked into it. So we use this for calculating, especially in the case of by doing it. I didn't show that's a paper published by RN International conference. Okay. Interestingly, then Pradesh Radhakrishnan talks about Palitu Vairam, the measurement comes into milligram. When it talks about some stones, it is 1 gram. So what we could understand is by reducing, when we match, we are able to visualize how that ornament would have looked at, how they have exactly selected the pearls of same size for Muthing Valayar, pearl bracelets. So we get to understand these kind of behaviors, how craftsmen work in making ornaments, how they were standardizing and using different kind of material. We are also able to, also in Pradesh Radhakrishnan, there is a reference to Rajavartham, which is actually lapis lazuli. That also we found. Rajavartham is also known as Lazban in Persian, and which is nothing but lapis lazuli. There are two ornaments in which they use, and lapis lazuli was also used as medicine. So by applying these measurements to these ornaments and descriptions in the inscription, we are able to visualize the ornaments and their size. Maybe if we find some, this can be useful for archaeological research in terms of correlating material culture, and it can be extended to the earlier or later period.
Formation of regions, etc. That is possible. disturbed. So that should be there. Another request is that diacritical marks are extremely necessary. For example, you gave us a term, T-H-U-N-I. Without diacritical, we pronounce it Tuni. Tuni, close. If you put the diacritical mark, it becomes Tuni. U with a hyphen on U and Na with a dot beneath the N.
Okay, I will.
So, Tuni is the correct term to be used. So, if you give the diacritical marks, then it explains itself. So, please give us the diacritical marks also and the historical, socio-historical explanation of regional variation, because it is necessary. This is an extremely scientific item which has to be explained historically. Otherwise, it may become an imaginary thing.
No, so because the thing is, what we proceeded was based on the ground reality. To work on the social historical aspect, we need to do more analysis. So the first stage, what we have done is to collect the data and present it. In terms of, if you want to see some social historical interpretation, it has to be based on more research. Not if we jump into any conclusion, it can be a problem. So we stuck to looking at the way how people are ordering the space. So that it becomes a kind of empirical study. In terms of interpretation, there could be a lot of variation. That can follow at the second level. So we stopped at this level. Yeah, you are right. I think I should put that critical one, which is very important. Thank you.
In Kerala, we used a wooden for Maha, especially for persons. Another one is Panjari.
Punjabi, yeah, is basically the same. Two wooden forms.
Or the Indian wood.